Wall Street surges back, Telstra comes up with a show and tell, and why are we bashing banks so hard? I reckon there's an economic implication of all this. I'm Peter Switzer.
I'm Paul Rickard.
And we're mad about money. All right, Paul, let's kick off with this surge on Wall Street. Good news?
Well, it is good news, Peter, because we had a tough week last week. I'm not sure our market's going to respond too much to it today.
But, I'd be mad if it doesn't, but you're probably right.
It's sort of like, I think it's October blues we're going through. I mean, Wall Street's got some good reasons. I mean, obviously earnings season, it's worried about that. Targets are higher, 19% growth in profits. Mm. Last night, some really good results from a couple of companies, and it needs good results to sustain momentum. Yeah. We've just sort of caught the, Wall Street sneezed a little bit, we caught the cold, and we're stuck where we are a little bit. So I think it's a question of a bit of apathy in our market. It couldn't go much above 6,300. I couldn't find a reason to buy it. Lots of sort of negativity coming out of Canberra, the by-election, shortest change in imputation credits. I don't know what it is. Australia's just being negative. Yeah. That's why we sold off harder, and we probably won't recover as well today. But it should have been up there anyhow.
Yeah, I think we'll probably sneak high. I think there's been overselling. The fact that our Switzerland Dividend Growth Fund went to ridiculously low levels, and it's going to rebound after being, $2.65 not long ago. So I think there's been an overselling. But I think the interesting thing is that the Yanks are actually showing that they're actually growing really well, and the big banks have reported very well. And I think there's been an overreaction. But on the same point, last week I was saying that the US market had gone too high. It needed a bit of a pullback. But I think the concerns were overdone. Let's go to Telstra, because that's a story that's really interesting, Paul, and you would have looked at the numbers.
Yeah, I mean, the first strike yesterday, I think 62% of shareholders voted against the pay rise and the remuneration.
Shareholders strike back.
I mean, they do need to strike back. I mean, Telstra has been a chronic underperformer. And the thing about Andy Penn is that he was so slow to act. Yeah. I mean, maybe the strategy is right now, question mark. It's all about whether they can actually deliver. Mm. It's too early to call. That's why I haven't been into the sort of rally on Telstra. But look, I think that's what shareholders were saying yesterday. You can't pay this guy because he did nothing for the first 18 months he was there, by and large. Yeah. It was clear they had a huge cost problem.
It was like a kangaroo caught in the headlights because of post-David Thodey. Thodey was a genius, so he didn't know what to do.
He was a CFO who was promoted to a CEO and showed he was probably the wrong man for the job. Mm. Maybe he's now currently growing into the role, question mark, time will tell, but nothing happened. And so I think Telstra board's out of step, and it deserves to be slapped down by shareholders. People have lost a lot of money on Telstra.
Yeah. Paul, is Telstra a buy at these levels, or do you want it to go lower before you come back in?
I wanted to go a bit lower, Peter. I'm not into Telstra just at the moment. I think the challenges in that market, I mean, the only positive thing that I think has happened in Telstra is really the position of TPG and Vodafone. Yeah. That was a big positive. We didn't see that when it was down at 285 and 260, 270. That's a big positive, taking out some competition. But I'm still not convinced that they're going to be able to get the 5G right, and they've really got a growth plan in place. So I think, we've got to see evidence of this new strategy, their cost-out plan actually working.
Yeah.
Before I think you rush back and tell them, the dividend will come down next year.
But it also seems like telcos are a bit like supermarkets. I don't have to buy them.
You don't have to.
And it's so competitive, it's so tricky. I'm getting out. But let's go to the point I really want to push today. Okay. The US market is doing really well. Our market is not doing very well. The US economy is doing well. Our economy is doing well. But somehow our stock market's not reacting to it. And I think it's the bashing of the banks that really are coming back to haunt us. Phil Lowe, who's the boss of the Reserve Bank, he's indicated he's worried about, the words he uses, was tighter credit. Now, what does that mean, Paul?
Well, what it means is it's just harder to get a loan.
That's right.
And that's what it means.
And I'm blaming APRA and the Royal Commission, scaring the pants of the banks, and people can't get loans, and therefore they're not buying homes, and house prices are falling, and businesses can't get loans, so they're going after these high interest rate lenders out there. This is ridiculous. Look, punish the banks for their bad behaviour by making them compensate the people who have been hurt. Have a tribunal for that. But don't stop people from getting money.
Well, I think it's almost time to love our banks, Peter. And I mean, like, it's gone to just such an extreme. Yeah. I mean, look, I've been wrong on the banks this year. I still think the banks are a buy. Yeah. I'm out of step with the market. No one in the market loves them. Yeah. I love them a little bit, in inverted commas. Yeah. But you're right, the bank bashing is not helping. It's not helping confidence in the economy. No. It's not helping lenders, not helping the home. The value of your homes are sinking a little bit because of the bank bashing, right?
Yeah.
So let's get on board. Let's actually realise, okay, bad behaviour. It needed to be punished. They needed to compensate, which is what they're starting to do. But we don't need the economy to freeze up because there's everyone's too scared out there, and the banks are afraid to lend because they're getting bashed by everybody.
And what's really interesting is, you know, apparently we all hate the banks, except when they do surveys. The banks are actually loved in this. Like, there's like 89% love their bank, 11% don't. And you know what? The time you really love a bank is when you find that dream home and then you go off and try and get a loan and they say yes. You love the bank that day. And there might be problems in the future, but on that day, when they say yes for your dream home, you love the bank. They've got their problems, but not, they're not as bad as what I think some people in politics would like to say.
And I think for investors, we're about to move into bank reporting season. We've got the ANZ, National Australia Bank and Westpac all reporting towards the end of October, the first week of November. That's going to be really important, I think, for investors.
Yeah.
Just to get a sense on whether, you know, all the negativity is really, it's really starting to impact on margins and profits. Sure, and just what progress they're making in taking out costs. I've always said the banks to me are a cost outplay, right? They've got lots of costs, lots of branches, lots of networks. Revenues are going to be challenged because things can't grow, and margins are hard because they can't raise any prices because of all the Royal Commission and other factors at play. It's really a cost out story. Let's see what progress they've made in taking out costs. So coming up, I think the ANZ is probably the first report, 31st of October. I'll check the date. But that's going to be really important for investors. And look, they've been so badly sold off. I still think they're a buy. I'm out of step, but I've been saying a broken record now for some time.
Yeah, well, I think you're right, because even if you're wrong, you still end up with a nice fat dividend. And eventually banks will be forgiven. And the share price will rise, but we might have to wait for that. I'm Peter Switzer.
I'm Paul Rickard.
And we're mad about money.
Content has been prepared without taking account of an individual's financial objectives, needs, or financial situation. It does not constitute formal advice. Before acting, any individual should consider the appropriateness of the information, having regard to the individual's financial situation, needs, and financial objectives. Past performance is not a guide for future performance. AFSL 286531.